The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the iniquities of the selfish and the tyranny of evil men. Blessed is he who, in the name of charity and goodwill, shepherds the weak through the valley of darkness. For he is truly his brother's keeper and finder of lost children. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee. Ladies and gentlemen, the Church of Laszlo has begun.
Yo.
Yo.
Oh, do you have an answer?
Oh, no, we don't have an answer. We're sitting here. So what happened was the jury came in. I know Julia loves hearing about the Amber Heard, Johnny Depp trial, but I got all these notifications earlier that said, you know, the verdict is coming. You know, click on whatever app you want. So I had Court TV running in the background anyway when I was working there. So I switch over. They've got a live camera in the courtroom. The judge walks in. The lawyers come in. You know, everyone stands up, and it looks like, okay, we're going to get the verdict. But as the judge is looking through the paperwork, she goes, oh, I need everyone to come up to the bench, which they said means there's a problem. You know, when I say they said that, the Court TV people said that because I'm getting all my information from them. I'm not a lawyer. Mm-hmm. And when they, you know, went back, the judge explained to the jury, listen, when you have something here that says, you know, someone was defamed or whatever, for each one of these instances, you need to put compensation in there. What type of compensation? It could be, it's got to be, you know, it could be a dollar. It could be whatever. There's apparently different ways, punitive ways, whatever. But you have to put, you have to fill out the rest of this form, basically. So she sent them back to fill it out. But then the Court TV people said, well, this means that someone won this case. But don't forget, Johnny sued her, and then she countersued him for like $100 million. So, and he wasn't asking for money, was he? He was just, was he asking for money? I think he just was trying to say that she defamed him, right?
No, I don't think he was asking for damages.
But either way, these lawyers now have just been sitting live on TV trying to fill this void, and they're going, well, someone won, which they also pointed out, apparently, according to them, is very rare for a public figure, a celebrity, to win a defamation case in the United States of America. They can try them, but a lot of times for a celebrity, they'll just say, well, you know, sorry. So they said the fact that somebody won this is pretty crazy because they a lot of these people at least weren't expecting it. So, and you kind of forget that she countersued. So I'm like, well, if somebody won, then he won, right? He was suing her for defamation.
Right.
But I forget, no, he was countersuing her. So don't worry. I'm watching.
All right. Well, I'm excited.
What is Court TV going to do when this is over? No one knew that Court TV
There'll
had
be
a
something
website.
Else.
Yeah, they're going to have to figure out
something. Oh, they're already running promos for the Tara Grinstead murder. For that
trial. Okay. Yeah, that,
they always
could
say,
be good.
Like, after Depp versus Heard.
But see,
watch this.
For that, you had to like listen to the podcast and everything to care. With Johnny Depp, he's a massive celebrity.
Sure.
It's going to be tough to match that. But I did get kind of an itch. It reminded me, Laszlo and I are old enough to remember the 90s when Court TV was like a thing. After OJ, there were so many trials that you could watch on Court TV and people talked about it. It was fun.
The Kennedy one.
Yeah.
The Kennedy
one
was crazy.
It seemed like every couple months there was one. Maybe not. It wasn't as big as this, and you weren't watching it every day. But I don't know. I felt like I watched a lot of Court TV back in the day.
The Kennedy one, I remember every time you know he took the stand to defend himself, and the lawyer would ask him a question, he would go, and then he would have the perfect answer. And they're like, people are like, we don't know if this is good or not, but he always gives a perfect answer. But it was like he would take 15 seconds
like
and be like, you know what? Let me go ahead and think about this for a second and then give you the perfect answer. And you're like, damn.
Right.
Like, he took time. And I remember the lawyer, and I always remember this. Court TV is so exciting. I remember the lawyer. His lawyer was Bud Black.
Wow.
And Bud Black... and I thought it was such a great comment, and I haven't heard it used since. But he was like, the state keeps telling you that the Kennedys have all this money and that they can get out of anything because they have all of this money and they can spend it on all these things. He's like, I want to break down what the state paid in this prosecution. Here's what a blood splatter analyst gets paid.
Right.
Here's, they had three helicopters fly over their place. And he just went through it all. And it was like hundreds of millions. Like just, and he's
right.
like, they don't have that much money. They
right.
don't have more money than the entire federal government. It's just, it's not true. So when you start talking about who's got more money to try to make this thing look like go their way, it's the state.
That's
it ain't
argument.
The Kennedys. And I was like, well, I think everybody was like, damn, I never thought about
right.
how much do they pay the cops? How much do
right.
they pay the FBI agents. How much do they pay DNA?
Labs, you know, right? The labs are super
expensive.
We
afford one. We could afford one.
Maybe, yeah.
They had like five.
Yep.
Right? And it was really kind of interesting.
That's a good point, yeah. We watch those shows. You see forensic files and all that stuff. We know what goes into it. But you do have this kind of perception that a wealthy person... Now, they get better lawyers.
Right.
They get a lawyer that reminds us of that.
As opposed to my lawyer is like, I'm real sorry.
Right.
Really, I don't...
So who do you think, if you
had to guess... He wasn't there? And I'm like, yes, he was. He was there. He was there.
If you had to guess...
Be sorry.
Who do you think won this thing while they're waiting? It seems like the jury's going to have to go back, fill all this stuff out.
It'll be interesting. I mean, clearly Johnny Depp won the court of public opinion.
Right.
But that's not... those things come back different all the time.
Exactly. So if he won the court of public opinion, he's getting standing ovations at the Jeff Beck shows or whatever. People seem to be on his
side.
Then
he really won.
Then I guess he won. He got. He
didn't want any money. He accomplished
what he
needed
to accomplish.
Right.
He changed the perception, right?
Right.
But when they came back,
I think if he loses, he becomes more popular.
Really?
I think if they say you owe her money, I think he becomes more popular because of how much people have rallied around him. They're going to be like, you got screwed.
Yeah. I don't know. I saw, there's been quite a few. I saw like an article from the New Yorker. I don't subscribe or anything. You know, I saw it linked somewhere and I read it. And it was this woman saying, basically, we shouldn't be watching this trial. And, you know, it's scandalous in a way. And we're taking Johnny's side when we weren't there. Now people are, you know, threatening Amber. And look, I will agree that chasing Amber out of court, yelling at her, on TikTok and saying things, just watch it. Just watch it on court TV. You know, we can discuss for it, but you don't have to threaten either one of them.
No.
Just give an opinion, and that'd be good enough. Otherwise, maybe we do need to take this court TV thing away. I don't know. But this has been the first time I've watched, like, a trial live as it was happening in a long time. And I think a lot of people, right?
Right.
We did not know that court TV existed. I didn't, at least, when this thing started. And I think you, Snowcone, said it's going to be on court TV. I was like, where's that? I thought that was True TV. Now you're like, there's an app. And we downloaded the app, and suddenly everyone's watching the Johnny Depp and Amber Heard trial.
Well, still nothing, as we know
it
right now.
It says jury was sent back to finish the verdict form. They didn't finish filling out the paperwork.
We'll have that decision as soon as it comes.
Oh, yes.
The Church of Laszlo.
All right, so you've got it all figured out now?
Hardly, but I've been trying. I watched the live coverage of the verdict and all that. I listened to all the court TV experts. Snowcone and I have both been trying to read different articles to see what kind of information we get, because it was a little confusing. As the jurors were reading, or as the judge was reading through, you know, each charge, you know, what did she defame him here? Was this article defaming? And they kept saying yes, yes, yes. They started adding the damages.
There.
He was not even there today. He already had a scheduled work commitment and wasn't
his
supposed to be there.
His scheduled work commitment was on tour with Jeff Beck.
Well, that's it. He was there like two nights in a row, right? Unless I misunderstood
that. Apparently
he was
supposed to be on tour with him this entire time. So he said, I'm not going to be there. I got a rock and roll show to play. You guys tell me.
Right. And last night,
in the end, again, whether you like him or not, it's just so badass. Like, look, I would be at the end of this thing when you guys decide if I'm guilty or she's guilty or whatever. But seriously, I'll be in Europe with Jeff Beck.
Right.
So figure it out. Like, it's still like, okay.
So, Snowcone, according to this article, it says Depp, who was not in court Wednesday due to the previously scheduled work commitment, sued for $50 million in damages in 2018 opinion editorial essay in the Washington Post. That sounds like they're talking about this trial. So he did have money on the line. And then she countersued him, right, for I think it was $100 million. Yeah, Heard's countersuit for $100 million said she was only ever violent with Depp in self-defense or defense of her younger sister. So they're just showing Amber's face as the judge is reading all these verdicts, right? And it was pretty long, but listen to this clip, because the judge is talking about the articles that Amber wrote about being the victim of domestic abuse, right? And as the judge is reading this, you can hear the people outside the courtroom screaming, Johnny. It's kind of creepy.
Amber Heard, I spoke up against sexual violence and faced our culture's wrath. That has to change. In the Washington Post online edition. Quote, then 2 years ago, I became a public figure representing domestic abuse, and I felt the full force of our culture's wrath for women who speak out, end quote. Do you find that Mr. Depp has proven all the elements of defamation? Answer, yes.
Isn't that a little odd? As you hear her reading the title of that, let's pretend that everything Amber said was true. Let's say that she was a victim and that this thing has been twisted. Just for argument's sake, right? I know the public is on his side, and now he's won the court case.
Right.
But just listening to that, I faced the public's wrath or whatever, and you hear people outside screaming, Johnny, Johnny. But look, this is the system working. This is what we complained about for years, a lot of people losing jobs and all these things. And we said, why doesn't this go to court? And I know sometimes it can be really difficult for, you know, depending on what kind of crime it was, especially for certain victims, to go to court, because then they could face wrath, you know, and scorn, especially if it's a football player or, you know what I mean? But with these celebrities, we saw it play out this time. The jury got to listen to all the witnesses. They got all the evidence, and they said,
I mean, it really could. I mean, if you think about it, this case changed a lot of things.
I think so.
It really could. And maybe some people would say for the worse, some people would say for the better, but in this country, if a woman says that you are abusive to her, first, she's probably not lying. Men are abusive, right?
Yeah, yes.
We know that. And so then we tend to just believe. But there are times, apparently, like in this Johnny Depp case, or times in America where a woman will call the police when the man hasn't done anything. And the man will get arrested and have to go to anger management court and all these other things, right? And be labeled as an abuser. At least at this case, if nothing else, again, for good or bad, I think men will say, hey, if you do that and I didn't do anything, there is a legitimate path to clear my name.
Right.
And that's the court system.
The legal system.
And it's a defamation lawsuit, and I had never thought of that before.
Right.
And right? Like, I never thought of it. You go, someone accuses you of something, you go to court, and they say not guilty, but people still think you're guilty.
Yeah.
Because it is what it is, right? Or someone accuses you of something, you go to court, and you just plea bargain it out. Like, you know, it has happened to me, and my lawyer has said, look, I'll just get you out. It's fine, but they're going to arrest you. I'm like, but I didn't do anything. They're like, yeah, it's fine.
Right.
I got you. If they plea bargain it out, then you just admit guilt, but you don't have to do anything, right? But it just makes it easier for everybody. I think he showed, like, maybe he shouldn't do that.
Yes, exactly.
And I loved his statement, which was, I'm doing this because I don't want my kids to read this stuff. Right. I don't want my family to read this stuff. I don't want my friends to read this stuff and just think, this is who I am.
Right.
Just because she accused me of it doesn't make it true, but if it's in the paper, right?
Mm-hmm.
If the accusations are out there and people are writing about it, then it is true, right?
Yes.
So I'm going to go here and clear my name, and I'm going to do it in court.
Through the legal system.
Right.
And don't you think, too, I said, let's pretend that everything she said is true. Now let's say that the jury was right, and that she weaponized what you're talking about, Lazlo.
Right.
The ability to, we do trust women because we know men are abusive.
Right.
We know that there are probably millions of women right now in a home in a bad situation.
Of course.
A scary situation, a dangerous situation. So we believe women, and I think we should.
And we should, right.
And I think we should. And because
and
of
I'm
that.
And I'm okay with starting with, and I know I shouldn't be, but I'm okay with starting with I believe you.
Absolutely.
But what I do like about this case is that he's like, yeah, I get it. You believe her? But we're going to go to court and let everything play out. And then you can believe who you want. As opposed to most men who just be like, I know you all believe I didn't do it, but, you know, I'll send out a tweet that says I didn't do it. And then everybody's like, you suck.
Right.
But I like the way that he at least went to court for it and said, hey, here's the facts. I'm going to lay them out the way I see them. She's going to lay them out the way you see them. You decide.
Yeah. And if you are one of these, and I get it, it's a very, very, very small percentage of people that would do this. But if you are someone that's going to weaponize that trust that we have, and say, you know what, I'm mad at this person, so I'm going to call the cops. Or I'm going to write an article or whatever.
Right.
Maybe this makes you think twice about that. Now, that could also be a bad thing. Because if you're telling the truth, and if she's telling the truth, you say, well, I shouldn't even tell my story now. Because there's a chance that if the person I'm telling the story about can get better lawyers than me or whatever.
Yeah, maybe. But, I mean, I think if you go to, like, this case, there's enough questions and enough lawyers that, you know, she had her truth and he had his truth. And one of them made a little bit more sense.
Yes.
Right? I don't know. Julia, how do you feel when you find out about all this?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting for the things that you've said, because you do hear a woman say that, and most of the time right away, you think, okay, I believe you, you know?
Right.
But there is always that sense, especially with everything that's happened in, like, the past 5 years with the movements, that, like, there is that chance that that can't be true about the guy, and you always wonder what's going to happen with that. So I think it's interesting seeing that they did this.
Right. Yeah.
And, like, for what I think about the case, I think that, yeah, I mean, I think that I believe Johnny's side.
Right.
Okay. So you do believe him. You think the jury made the right decision?
Yeah. I mean, based on everything that's true. I mean, listen, if she was the one that was telling the truth, then that's extremely sad.
Right.
Right. I agree with that. Agreed. If she was. But from what I can tell and what the jury could tell, I think, you know, kind of like, well, I think he's telling the truth.
It's something Lazo tried to teach me when I was younger. There's, because I know a lot of guys who are still like this that have never been in a relationship similar to this, right? And I'm not saying these are guys who are not abusive. They've been in relationships, but what they think is that's impossible. I couldn't be abused by a woman. I'm stronger than her. I'm taller than her. Whatever. That can't happen. And even though they know, like, well, I guess it, I've heard that it does happen. So I don't think
you don't recognize.
I don't think
it,
they recognize it once.
And
you've
it's usually not
it.
Physical. You yes. don't recognize it because it's not physical. And if you say, oh, my ex abused me, then, you know, people, guys, other guys are like, stop
right,
it.
Right.
As my therapist would say, it's not black and white. There's a lot of gray, especially with abuse.
Right.
Yes.
So.
But, you know, name calling and, you know, aggressive behavior and, you know,
blackmailing.
Right. Telling people that you suck and, you know, that saying things about men behind. All those things happen both ways. But to think that a guy can't be, I mean, to think that a guy can't be abused emotionally or verbally and be stuck in some sort of bad relationship and not know how to get out just because he's stronger.
Right, exactly.
You know, that's different.
That's
right?
What we need to fix. Right. That's what we need to fix, because there's too many people that don't understand that. Don't you
right.
think?
I agree.
I feel like I hear people when they're interviewing people on the streets, and I see some of these, I'm like, oh, this person doesn't quite understand, doesn't know about what goes on behind some closed doors.
Right.
You know, it's
and when I saw their relationship played out, you know, as they both described on both their parts, there's parts of it that you could absolutely, if you've been in those kind of Charles Bukowski relationships where you were like, yeah, I see how this happens.
Yeah.
There is a pound of cocaine on the table. There is whiskey. And Johnny even said, when I start doing drugs and drinking, there is a monster in me.
Yeah.
But I never did what she said. I'm not a good guy. This, right. You know what I mean? Like, the bad things happened. I did say things. We had proof of it. But what she said I did isn't true.
Right.
Right. Right. And we've all been there where it's like, man, this whole thing is, our whole relationship is just now at this point based on sex, booze, and drugs, and it's spiraling out of control. Right. And so to me, it seemed like in this case, that's where they both were.
Right.
And for her to exact revenge and continue to be what he said controlling was to write these articles, was to tell people about this. And that's really where he was like, you know what, you went too far.
Right. Exactly.
That's where I think he stopped. It was like, you know what, you went too far. Inside these walls, it was crazy time. I get it. I'm not perfect. But you started writing articles for The Washington Post about how I was a sexual abuser.
Well,
now that ain't it.
Who know? I don't know what happens now. I'm very interested by the whole pictures. You know, you saw the pictures, the picture of her on the cover of People magazine where it showed her bruised. And they brought this up in court, the idea that maybe she doctored these photos, the
right.
idea that she tried to make herself look like she was injured and then alert the press. You know, that guy from TMZ testified, oh, I'm going to go charge this guy with abuse and I want the press to be there. I've seen all these articles. Who knows if it's true? And I think, Snowcone, you probably heard people talking about it too, but there could be more that happens now, right? She could be charged criminally for doctoring those
photos,
right?
Yeah.
But who would do that? Who would bring those charges? Is it contempt?
I think it's like, unlikely.
I think it's probably unlikely, too. And do you understand what the $2 million was that she got?
I don't. She countersued, so it was something that they thought that, you know, she was correct about with one of her countersuits, I guess.
Yeah, I just don't understand. They, you know, as they were adding it up, it was $5 million for this. So then he ended up with what, $15 million total?
I think he gets 15 and she gets 2.
And she gets 2, but I don't know what
they said.
The
2 was, if I say the word wrong, tell me, but compensatory.
Okay.
But not punitive. So she must have sued for something like, hey, I had lawyer fees or something that I didn't need to have, and you need to compensate me for this. And that's $2 million. So they did have him compensate her for some sort of charge, but it was not punitive.
Okay.
So his was punitive. She got comped for something, but that they just said it was compensatory, but they didn't say what that charge was, like, not charge, legal charge, what that cost was for.
Okay.
But he didn't ask for anything, right?
It says he asked for
$50 million.
Okay, he did.
$50 million, she asked for $100 million.
Damn. I'm not sure I knew that.
Now, I don't think this one, I just found another article here, but I don't, because it says the jury found that Depp is entitled to $10 million, And compensatory damages and punitive damages of $5 million. Okay, so that's up to date, right? Depp sued Heard, his ex-wife, for $50 million, saying she defamed him. I don't see the $2 million, but I get what you... Okay, it says the jury also decided in her countersuit and awarded her $2 million in damages. So that is part of... You know, even though she countersued for $100
million, right.
I guess they must have thought something was worth a couple million dollars.
Right,
and that's really
that
weird,
was.
Too, that the judge said, okay, the jury's here, they've got a verdict, and they hadn't put in any damages. So then the judge says, jury, you got to go back and fill out how much money it is. That did not take very long. Like, what were they just like, how much should we do? I mean, what happens in a jury like that?
It was like 10 minutes.
Imagine if the four of us were in that jury, and I'm like, Julia, what do we do? Is it just like a couple million? Do we put zero? What do we do? Does she have money? Is it bad to put money? Do we do a million? They're celebrities, right? Like, there was no guidance. The judge just said, put something like zero or one or whatever.
Right.
And they're like, okay, how's 5 million for this? 5 million for this? It's crazy that this... we knew that this court trial was going to be televised and be a big deal, but it's a much bigger deal than I expected it to be, don't you think? And do you think that it relaunches Johnny Depp's career? Like, is he in demand now, or is he still? Does this kind of still tarnish him?
I think he's in demand now.
Okay.
If I were a movie producer, the way people are cheering him and talking about him on the internet, if I'm Tarantino and I'm thinking about making another film, if I'm Ridley Scott or I don't know, PTA, right? Yeah. Somebody like, yo, I got this script.
That's exactly right, I think.
You know,
Pirates of the Disney's not
more,
do it.
It ain't going to be like Alice in Wonderland,
right?
The kind of stuff you have been doing lately to get that paycheck, but it may be a little bit more like Blow and Donnie Brasco, and let's do one of those.
Yeah.
I would absolutely be like, you know what? Let's do that Donnie Brasco 2 thing, yes. Man.
The Church of Laszlo. It's time to doom scroll with Slim Fast.
What you don't know could kill
you. Murder hornets.
Corpies infected monkeys.
This is Headlines on the Church of Laszlo.
Yo, let's doom scroll, baby.
Yo. All right, so I guess we should just real quick do a very quick recap. The Johnny Depp Amber Heard trial. The jury came back today. They awarded Johnny $15 million in his defamation case against his ex-wife, and here's a little clip of the judge reading through the verdicts.
Amber Heard, I spoke up against sexual violence and faced our culture's wrath. That has to change. In the Washington Post online edition. Quote, then 2 years ago, I became a public figure presenting domestic abuse, and I felt the full force of our culture's wrath for women who speak out, end quote. Do you find that Mr. Depp has proven all the elements of defamation? Answer, yes.
All right, look, I mean, I think we talked about this. I think maybe the jury made the right decision based on the evidence, but I think that clip right there is just crazy. As she's saying, I faced, the wrath, and you hear people outside screaming, Johnny, Johnny. But look, I do like that it went to court. It went through the system that we've had in place for a long time because a lot of these cases don't. And, we've got a verdict. So there you go. Now, we got to talk about the school shooting in Texas because this is still in the news, and it should be in the news because I don't know how much you've been keeping up, Laszlo, with the story about the police and what's been going on down there with the police. And Snowcone, I know you probably have because it's all anyone talks about on Reddit news lately.
Yeah, it changes every day.
The police kept changing their story, right? Even the day of when they were giving those press conferences, they kept changing their story. And in the beginning, that cop said something about trying to blame the teacher. She put a brick in the door and propped the door open, and that's how he got in. And then later, with security footage and other officers who talked to the press, they said, no, that's not true. She went outside to get food, she came back and closed the door, and it didn't lock properly like it was supposed to. They keep walking back these statements, and now there's all kinds of confusion because the different departments are saying they're no longer going to cooperate with one another. That's really the big story.
This morning, new questions about how the gunman got into Robb Elementary School and carried out his deadly rampage. Authorities changing their story on Friday, saying that a teacher left a door propped open, allowing the gunman to enter.
The teacher runs to the room 132 to retrieve a phone, and that same teacher walks back to the exit door, and door remains propped open.
But this morning, the teacher's lawyer telling the San Antonio Express News she had propped the door open to get food from her car. She saw the gunman crash his truck, ran back into the classroom to get her phone and dial 911, and then closed the door shut after realizing the gunman was heading toward the school. Her lawyer saying, quote, she thought the door would lock because the door is always supposed to be locked. Now, the Texas Department of Public Safety walking back their earlier comments and confirming the teacher's story.
Okay, now here's the big headline, Laszlo.
Okay.
Uvalde Police School District no longer cooperating with Texas probe of shootings. says the Uvalde Police Department and the Uvalde Independent School District Police Force are no longer cooperating with the Texas Department of Public Safety's investigation into the massacre at Robb Elementary School and the state's review of the law enforcement response. Multiple enforcement sources tell ABC News. So there's this probe going on because their stories kept changing, and obviously the public wants to know why they were waiting outside. It appeared that they were waiting outside. We know that he was in there for a long time. Parents were trying to get in there themselves. So it's a bad look. And then when the cops keep changing their story, it's an even worse look because it looks like the cops are trying to blame maybe a teacher. They're trying to blame video games. I mean, it's totally bizarre. So now for them to say, we're not even going to cooperate anymore, this police department, I can only imagine the mayhem that's going on inside, behind closed doors, the damage control. And look, we don't know all the facts. It looks bad.
When you hear that, you hear, who's not cooperating with the authorities?
The Uvalde?
The authorities.
Right. And the
school. Wait, but the authorities aren't cooperating with the authorities now?
Exactly.
The authorities want to ask the authorities some questions, and the authority says, you ain't answering any questions. I don't need to know anymore.
Right, you're
literally lying. I don't need to know anymore.
You
when I'm like,
up.
Yeah, you know what, boy, we'd like to answer your questions, but we ain't doing it. You know who does? Who says that? People like me.
Yes.
People like me. When the lawyers come, like, you know, we'd like to talk to you. I'm like, poof, I would not like to talk to you.
Right.
At all.
Right.
Ever.
So you've got the.
You should label me as uncooperative.
Exactly.
I'm uncooperative.
You've got the city police department, right? The Uvalde Police Department. And then what's confusing is you've got the Uvalde Independent School District Police, okay?
Right.
So the Independent School District Police Force, these are the resource officers, I guess, which I thought were part of a national organization, but I'm very confused by the stories they keep updating. But both of those departments are no longer working with the Texas Department of Public Safety, who was investigating this whole response to the massacre.
Right.
They are in damage control.
Yeah,
what looked really bad, and I was hoping they would come with an answer to say this is why we did it, and we did the right thing, and we might have even saved lives by doing it this way. We were trained to do it. None of that ever happened. Instead, they kept changing their story, and now they're saying we're not going to talk. It's amazing. Hey, do you guys ever see these stories about pilots that fall asleep like in the air?
No.
There's been several instances. Apparently, this happens more than the airlines would like us to know. But
that's terrifying.
It is. Air traffic. You can go on.
I don't want to know
there's
that.
Autopilot. But what they do is they overshoot their landing. So you can go on YouTube and just look this up and watch different or listen to different instances of air traffic controllers trying to talk to the pilots, like, "Hey, you're here. Are you getting ready to land?" And they don't answer because they're asleep. Well, it just happened in a flight from JFK to Rome, Italy. They get there, there's the co-pilot or whatever is taking a nap. I guess he's allowed to. But while he's napping, Yeah, they take rest periods on intercontinental flights. They have multiple pilots, and they have like a restroom because you're only allowed to fly for so many hours or whatever. So they do have a room where they can go rest depending on how many pilots they have. So one of these pilots was allowed to rest.
I don't either.
Mm-mm. No.
Used to be on these really big planes, you know, those old Boeings, they might have three or four pilots in
there. How long is a flight are they talking?
I don't know. We should look up how long this flight is, but this guy was taking a nap, and it could be that it's because by law he has
to. Who's flying the plane?
The pilot. There's a pilot, there's a co-pilot.
Right.
Oh.
But the co-pilot should be napping.
Apparently that's what they do, but yeah.
Like anything we do is a partner-partner thing. We should both be awake for it.
Yep. Well,
if it's a tag team wrestling match, I don't want you to take a nap because, like, I got this part. That's
not
okay.
Especially putting a giant vessel through the air.
Right.
Well, it sounds like this pilot who was supposed to be actually flying the plane. Once he gets close, air traffic control is like, "Hello, are you ready to start, you know, the landing procedures?"
Okay.
No answers.
The two pilots allegedly falling asleep 38,000 feet in the air. Now, this was a massive plane, an Airbus 330, with as many as 250 passengers on board. It was a flight from JFK to Rome last month and over France. While the first officer was on his designated sleeping break, investigators say the captain allegedly fell asleep too. Air traffic controllers losing contact for about 10 minutes. They were so concerned, fighter jets were prepared to intercept, but the pilots eventually started responding.
So they have fighter jets that are ready to go up there and figure out, do we need to shoot this plane down? Is it about to crash into a building or something? Has it been, you know, taken over? And you're just in the back like, shouldn't we be there by now? You know, you can't see the pilots. You're sitting in that chair. All you can see is your knees.
Isn't there like I was going to say stewardess, but
flight attendant.
A waitress in the sky, and she, can't she go up there and wake them up?
She's supposed to have a code to get through that door. So, you know, I don't know. Maybe she doesn't realize that we've overshot now. Like, we've been in the air for too long. But they were over France. And apparently that they're trying to reach them, like, hey. Mm. And they can't get it. But it happens in the United States. You can go on YouTube and find these different videos, like, hello. And then finally a guy will come back and be like, hey, sorry, my radio wasn't working, which is what this pilot said to. But then they always investigate and like there was nothing wrong with the radio. You fell asleep. It happens a lot. Right. Look, I'm not a pilot. So, but I would think that if I've got all these passengers and I'm 38,000 feet in the air, that
you would think if we even without the passengers,
right?
You're in it.
Yep.
Like I want to land this thing correctly because I'm in it.
Right.
Even
right.
if I feel no empathy towards anyone else, I am in this.
Right.
It's not like I'm flying. It's a drone, and right. I'm on the ground safe. And I'm like, man, I might take a nap. Who cares about these idiots? I'm in the goddamn plane.
Exactly. It's weird. It's just
why I stay awake while I'm driving a car.
Yep.
Not for you.
Yep.
I know people would say that's for other people, but in my world, it's just for me.
Right.
I don't want to hit you because I could get hurt.
Okay, so there's kind of a glass half full way of looking at this too, though. If these pilots is are also comfortable falling asleep,
what did you say?
I said, "Is there?"
Yeah, I don't. I'm not saying I think this, but right. you could say
I'm with you, Julia. Well, I don't know.
I don't like
if
it.
They fall asleep, if they fall asleep, maybe these pilots know that these planes fly themselves so well they don't even need me. No, I don't agree with that.
No, we're not going that way.
But I'm saying these pilots must be real comfortable with autopilot when they get up there.
No.
Okay. Moving on, Lazo, you lived in the Keys, right?
I did, yes.
Was that after Jacksonville?
Not only did I live in the Keys, I went to jail in the Keys.
Oh, that's right. You went to jail there. Mm-hmm. Did you ever parasail there?
Yeah, for sure.
So a lot of parasailing. Of course, there's a lot of parasailing at a lot of beaches. But
I loved living in Cuba. I mean, it was tough. I mean, it's only tough because the cops are bad there. Like, you wouldn't expect it.
Like another country or something?
Like, they just want to arrest you because there's this giant prison on an island in the Keys, right?
Oh, it's like Alcatraz?
Right, but, and that's where you go. It's a jail slash, but I mean, it's huge. And it's federally funded.
Okay.
So they have to have a certain amount of people in there. It's like a hospital.
Yeah.
So they arrest people all the time for like DUIs on bikes, public drunkenness. And you're like, I'm in Key. I remember I had to go face a charge in Detroit, and they brought up my charges in Key West, and part of it was public drunkenness. And the judge in Detroit was like, you're in Key West. That's like saying you got in trouble for gambling in Vegas. Like, is there, like, you're not allowed to be drunk in public in Key West? Everybody in the courtroom in Detroit actually started laughing. Like, how is this even a thing?
Right.
Really? Like, how, you're in Key West? You're not allowed
I'm
to
drunk
drink?
Now. Right.
Right. But, in Key West, they arrest you for that stuff all the time.
Well, a couple was visiting. I think they were from Illinois. They'll say in the story. And they went parasailing. I've been parasailing once. Julia, have you ever been parasailing?
No.
You look
I'm
like
scared.
A parasailer.
I thought for sure she would have done
I
it. Me
look
too.
Like a parasailer? You, what about yeah. me looks like a parasailer?
You look fun. You do fun things.
Yeah, you do fun things.
I don't think you say no
but
to
but I'm
a
also
lot of
a little bitch when it comes to going high up.
Okay, oh, see, we didn't know. Just because you do like I'm like, oh, if anybody swam with dolphins, it's her.
Yeah.
If anybody,
I would swim with dolphins.
Right, if anybody was like, oh, I went to this place and what?
Parasailing or
I know.
Did this
I get,
real fun thing, I would think Julia,
me too,
right?
Me too.
I know, but I scare easy.
Okay. So now we know that about you. Well, this poor couple, they're on this boat, and if you've ever parasailed, you know, when I did it, I was like, this is fun. And then you get to a point where you're looking down, and you're like, oh, that water. When I did it, I was with my ex, and she goes, what would happen if we fell right now? And I said, you would die. She's like, no, there's
she
water there.
While you were up there?
Yeah, because she wasn't scared at all when we started. And then she goes, what would happen? I said, you would die. And she goes, no, it's water. And I said, yeah, we're like 400 feet in the air. That's like landing on concrete. You would
go
die.
Go right to a shark's mouth.
And she suddenly was like, I want this to end. And she was never scared of anything like that. But suddenly it clicked like, oh, this is dangerous. I thought it was fun. There was nothing around, though. We did it in a big, empty, open space. When I saw the news footage of this, this parasailing was going on near a bridge, and there was a big wind gust. Apparently, the weather changed suddenly. So for some reason, they cut the sail off of the boat because they couldn't control it anymore. That's a thing? I'm very curious about this. Then the couple in the parasail are, you know, flying uncontrolled, and they slam into a bridge and die.
Oh, they slam into the giant bridge that connects Key West?
It could be. Look up...
So, like, there's a giant bridge that when you travel, there's all these little bridges, right? And you leave Miami, and you keep going. It's one road, and there's all these bridges. And then to get to Key West, there's a giant long bridge that connects that.
I've seen that on TV before.
Right. Like you see like in there's a Schwarzenegger movie, there's one where they're chasing him over the bridge.
Yeah.
That bridge that they did the movie on is next to the new bridge. You can see it. And it's where they fell off of it isn't part of a bridge anymore.
Okay, there's that show on Netflix, Bloodline, I used to watch. And there's a scene where he drives across that bridge. I've never been to the Keys, but it looks cool.
High winds played a role in a deadly parasailing accident in the Florida Keys. A tourist from Illinois was killed on Monday, and her nephew and son were hurt when they hit a bridge during a parasailing ride. Officials say a strong gust of wind took hold of the parachute. When the boat could no longer control the chute, the captain cut the line, and the chute dragged the three along the water.
I can't imagine why he would cut the line.
Yeah, they said they couldn't control the chute anymore, so he cut the line. Okay, so he just died, and then his son and they said his son and nephew were injured. I mean, when you see the picture, if you look up Florida Keys parasailing, you'll see the news stories. I don't know, maybe you'll recognize that bridge, but I'm very curious why they would cut the rope. And also, I guess in the Keys, there's bridges everywhere because it's all islands, right? So they got to
connect
them.
Well, there's only one going one way.
Okay.
But it doesn't say, did they say they were in Key West?
They just said they were in the Keys.
Yeah, see, they could be in like Almirada or something.
See, I'm unfamiliar with all that.
There's like a bunch of keys leading up to it.
Okay.
And they're all kind of touristy, different, right?
Okay.
Some of them are more laid back. Some of them don't have anything on them. Some of them just have like hotel rooms and one big bar. Some of them are like for more adult stuff. Like my grandparents used to go camping in certain islands of the Keys and then just go fishing and stuff.
Okay.
And then you get all the way to Key West, and that's where, you know, it looks like, well, no, it looks like a small, it looks like a small New Orleans. It looks like it's basically based on it. It looks like a small, you know, Bourbon Street.
But doesn't it look like once you get down there far enough, I mean, in the videos that I've seen, at least, it looks like you're now in the Caribbean, like you're on, you know, you're in Puerto Rico or Cuba.
Oh, yeah,
or something.
And there's like Bahamian Village where the people from the Bahamas live and there's chickens running around.
Right.
Sure.
Yeah, it's cool. You're like, this
feels
America?
Like that.
Yeah. So anyway, now we got a goal, Julia. We're going to go parasailing sometime.
No.
Yes, we are.
Absolutely not.
Yes,
these last two stories you've told have been very unsettling.
It's time to doom scroll with Slim Fast. What you don't know could kill you.
Murder hornets.
Corpies infected monkeys.
This is Headlines on the Church of Laszlo.
Yo! All right, we doom scrolling some more?
We're doom scrolling some more. So this war in Ukraine, it's been going on a long time, right? And we don't talk about it every day because there's not necessarily big enough updates and we don't know what the hell we're talking about anyway.
I thought it was over.
You thought it was over?
I feel like everybody just stopped talking about it.
Oh, they're still talking about it. Russia's made a little bit of progress. But this, I think this is big news because the United States is sending rocket systems over to Ukraine, okay? The Biden administration says we're going to send these four sophisticated medium-range rocket systems and ammunition to help stall Russian progress. But the thing is, I guess these rockets can shoot about 50 miles. So the United States has told Ukraine, hey, listen, we're going to give you these, and we're going to give you the ammunition, but don't shoot them into Russia, because you can only shoot them at, you know, if Russian troops are inside your border.
Hey, you gotta promise me.
That's exactly what they said. Like, don't shoot them into Russia, because obviously that would, it already looks bad to Russia that we're, you know, everything, the embargoes, and now we're sending them all this ammunition, but now we're sending them these rockets that they could easily shoot, right, into Russia, and we're telling them, don't do that. Don't shoot it into Russia.
It's a long-range rocket system, and the Ukrainians already have an old Soviet system like this that has this kind of range, but what this HIMARS does is add GPS precision to each rocket. So now you can put that rocket within a 20 to 30-foot circle, and so that precision was going to give the Ukrainians the ability to target things very precisely.
I just thought, it's such an amazing headline to say, you know, the United States sends rockets and makes Ukraine promise they won't shoot them into Russia. I guess what happens if they shoot one into Russia, then Biden has to go on TV and tell Putin, like, look, we told them not to. It's not our fault. We told them not to shoot them into Russia. So this thing is still going on. And I saw also today, or maybe yesterday, that Russia has said if they capture Volodymyr Zelensky, he will be tried as a war criminal. Which is just, I can't believe that, honestly, by now that they haven't found him. He is going to go down in history, right? I mean, people are going to talk about him for a long time. I really think he's going to go down in history.
Absolutely.
And it's always hard to tell when you're living it, but it certainly seems that way. Catalytic converters getting stolen. Has anyone here had distracted by a text.
I feel bad. I apologize.
Have you had your catalytic converter stolen ever?
Do I have one?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
All right. I thought maybe fuel injected, I don't know. Have a carburetor?
It's part of your exhaust.
Do I have a carburetor?
No, you do not.
But I used to.
You used to probably, yeah.
Yeah, see, that's
time,
I don't know, right.
Yeah, but you're...
I don't have a catalytic converter and a carburetor. Don't know the difference.
The catalytic converter is part of the exhaust, and what it does is it captures a lot of the poisonous gas and stuff that's coming out of your exhaust so it doesn't go out into the air. So it tries to clean up the exhaust as much as possible.
Why do people steal them?
Because
there's precious metals.
There's a lot of precious metals in there that are kind of look like honeycombs that they use to capture all these poisonous gases.
What kind of precious metals?
I don't know, but it's worth a lot of money, and they get stolen a lot, and I'm sick and tired of it because they're stealing them here in our building. They told us a couple months ago, hey, don't park right here because you didn't know this snow cone? Oh, yeah, like a month and a half ago, our boss came in and said, he said, don't park over there. Two of them got stolen this morning.
What the hell?
Yes, they're getting, so now in Phoenix, they go to this, they think this guy's been stealing catalytic converters. they capture this guy, and this guy has stolen, well, he's got 1,000 probably stolen catalytic converters in his possession.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
I go to Snow Cone's Kia.
Mm-hmm.
I open up the hood. I know how to get a catalytic converter.
It's underneath
out of there,
the car. Right?
Okay, whatever. I go underneath. I know how to get it. I bring it home. I have 1,000 of them. Who do I sell a catalytic converter to?
Just about anybody. So get this. This is the worst
like
part.
Like anybody? Lazo. Like I just put it on Craigslist and I have a catalytic converter?
Not just that. So this just happened to my sister-in-law.
Yeah.
Her catalytic converter got stolen.
Which one?
Martha, the one that you like. Her catalytic converter got stolen. Well, she got it fixed, but get this. When you go to the store.
Don't look at me like that, Julia. She's like, oh, God.
When you go to the shop to get it fixed, they will tell you. Now, maybe not all of them, but a lot of these shops will tell you, okay, a new one will cost you this much, but I can sell you a used one for this much. Well, where do you think they got the used one?
Are they the ones stealing it, or do you?
No, they're buying them. A lot of them are buying them.
Because I had a really good question.
Because
I was thinking people were going to the people who steal them to buy them. And I'm like, wouldn't they sell it to them and then just go remember who they sold it to and steal it from them again?
Right. I don't know. I mean, it seems that way. And it's become such a huge epidemic.
Here's my dumb question. If I go to start my car, does it not run without it?
Yeah, it runs. It sounds like...
I thought it makes a noise, yeah.
Oh, okay.
It sounds like your exhaust is gone.
You guys not have this happen that much around you? Because for us, pretty normal.
It's happening all the time, and it's annoying me. And I say what we do is we punish these people with severe punishment so that
they
stop stealing.
Why don't we make a catalytic converter without precious metals? And why? Who cares about the precious metals if you just sell them to be used? As catalytic converters again.
Because it's still worth money. So the catalytic converter is worth a decent chunk of change, and the guy at the shop who's buying it from you might give you a decent
money for it. No, he's not buying it for the precious metals. He's buying it to use it for its intended purpose.
Right, which it needs precious metals in it to work. So, yeah, you
right.
can sell it. But what I'm saying is a lot of these shops have these used catalytic converters, and I assume that they're buying stolen catalytic converters, just like they buy stolen airbags and other things. But now catalytic converter theft has become like the biggest thing.
It almost sounded like the exhaust had fallen off. That's very frustrating. You feel so violated.
Before this thing started, we would see maybe one vehicle every month. Now we see 3 to 5 a day.
3 to 5 a day. What happens is you call the police and you can say, hey, my catalytic converter got stolen in the parking lot of this, you know, retail store. They have security cameras. The police are not going to go into that store and ask to see security footage and look at the person who stole the catalytic converter. It's not important enough to them.
Right.
So these thieves go around and steal them basically right in front of you. They can do it in broad daylight, and the cops aren't going to go after them. You tell the cops, hey, my catalytic converter got stolen. They'll take a report maybe, but that's it. Even if it's on camera, they're not looking for it. So they're just getting stolen like crazy. Trust me, Lazo, if and when it happens to you, you're going to be angry too. It's really annoying.
Well, of course I'll be angry.
And it happened to our station when we used to have a station vehicle, you know, for the radio station.
Mm-hmm.
Got stolen like 3 times in the parking lot. I say 50-year minimum if you get caught stealing a catalytic converter. 50 years.
That 50 years?
50 years. That should stop it, right?
I think that might be over the top.
All right, how much you give them?
For stealing a catalytic
converter? We got to stop it somehow. So how do we,
I don't know.
I say 50 years, and if you guys don't have a better plan, then I say 50 years if you get caught stealing a catalytic converter. It's annoying.
Seems extreme.
Did you see that toddler in your state, Lazo, in Lawrence, Kansas?
Mm-hmm.
That kid who wandered into the pool. You hear all these stories about pools and how dangerous they are for kids from like 1 to 4. I think they said
it was the
leading cause of death. Yeah, I believe it was in Lawrence. So did you see the video, Snowco?
I did, yeah.
This toddler wanders off and just kind of walks into the pool, can't swim, and is drowning.
What like a public
pool? It's like an apartment complex, right?
It's like an apartment complex, like a gate around it.
And so there was a kid. He sees this happening. He alerts dad. Dad jumps over the fence, comes over, gets this kid out. The kid is unresponsive. In the video, you can see it. He's limp. It's horrible to watch. I thought, oh, my God, that kid's dead. The dad performs CPR on this kid. He's not this kid's dad. He performs CPR on him and saves his life. Absolutely amazing.
4-year-old Xavier Rigney gets inside the locked, gated pool at his apartment complex and jumps in. Instantly, the nonverbal child with autism is in trouble.
At this point, Xavier is drowning.
12-year-old Maddox Westerhouse went for his dad.
I just went like, oh no, and ran.
Some 3 minutes later, Tom Westerhouse jumped the fence, rescued Xavier, and started CPR. After 2.5 minutes, Xavier coughed up water and cried.
That is amazing. And the whole thing is on video. You can see it. At least we know that it has a happy ending. But, God, even knowing that, it's hard to watch. But can you imagine? I mean, if you see a kid in a pool drowning, you're going to go try and save him, right? If you're the only person around. Now, if I'm not the only person around, I'd probably say, Snow Cone, go get him. Someone else. I don't want to be responsible.
You guys keep because doing that.
I'm scared that I would do CPR wrong or something. Maybe someone else would do a better job. You know what I mean?
Okay.
If there's other people around, you might think, oh, I'm not going to be good at this.
But you're going to jump in right away.
Oh, absolutely. You're going to try and help him. That's instinctual. And then in the movies, I've seen CPR. We got taught it in school. But to watch that video and see it actually work.
Just quickly Google it on the side.
Right, yeah, right. Like, hurry up. I'll get my phone. Google it. Show me a video on YouTube. You got to watch a 15-second commercial.
Yeah. Oh, that would suck. That would suck.
This kid can't breathe. Like, damn you, YouTube. But that guy's a hero. Absolutely, 100%. He deserves all the fame that he's getting right now. And finally, Lazo, your AMC stock, I've been following
down today.
It's down a little bit. I'm a little worried because now they got a new problem to overcome. Have you heard about this? Movie theaters are afraid they might run out of popcorn. We have a baby formula shortage, right? Mm-hmm. And now we might have a movie theater popcorn shortage.
And movie theaters are afraid of running out of popcorn. The Wall Street Journal reports farmers have switched to higher paying crops that likely won't be a problem immediately. But they do say it could be later this year, maybe just in time for the holiday movie season. A trucker shortage also delayed popcorn shipments.
So you've got a problem with truckers, you got a shortage of truckers, and then apparently the farmers were like, I'm done growing corn, I'm going to grow something more profitable. I don't know what that is, probably chickpeas or something. People like hummus. I don't know what they're growing. But Lazo, that's all you got to worry about is the popcorn shortage. I feel like you could just replace the popcorn with something else.
They talked about making their popcorn. That they have so much of it that they were going to put it in stores.
Oh, so then your company's good to go.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that was the CEO announced that they're going to do AMC popcorn. You'll be able to buy it.
Okay.
At all the grocery stores.
The headline here from the New York Post says movie theaters experiencing popcorn and candy shortages. So, I don't know. I'm still rooting for you, Lazo. That
too,
stock's
buddy.
Low enough today. I might just buy some.
The Church of Lazo.
Yo.
Yo.
All right, what's going on?
Well, it's Wednesday, guys.
What does that mean?
That means?
GTK.
GTK. We keep it simple today. I like the questions that people asked on our subreddit, which, by the way, reddit.com/r/Church of Lazlo. L-E-Z-L-O. Go join it, and you can contribute. You can ask questions. One of the questions on here, though, said, I just want to know what everyone in the gang is currently watching on TV.
Oh.
What are you watching? Which I always like discussing, too, because it gives me good recommendations.
I've watched one episode of Severance with intent to watch more, but I have not.
It's so good.
Wait, which one's that? What's that?
That's on Apple. It's got... Yeah.
Oh, yes.
It's like very Black Mirror.
Is that the Ben Stiller?
Yes, Ben Stiller.
Yeah.
What's the guy's name?
I can't think of it. I know the comedian. I like that guy.
Adam Scott.
Yeah,
just
so
been
nice
out, so I haven't been watching TV, really.
That's the one I forget is the Apple TV. I use an Apple TV device, and so I have a subscription to it. I never open it.
I don't open it a lot, but I do if somebody tells me there's something.
That's what I do.
That show is worth watching.
Yes.
It is worth watching. It's good.
Okay.
And I want to watch the second season of Barry.
Yes. Okay. I have been watching that. Love, love, love Barry. You like Barry?
I do.
Okay.
I haven't watched the second season yet. Well, I watched Gaslit on Stars.
That, my brother
Unbelievable
has been
recommending
show.
That. Unbelievable show.
Now, that's based on the Slow Burn podcast, right? About the
Nixon, but you don't ever really see Nixon. It's about Martha Mitchell and John Dean, and you're watching it though, and it doesn't matter. But if you like history at all, and you're kind of interested in that stuff, like the people that they mention, you're like, oh, I know that name, but this is the guy, right?
Yeah,
like Zapruder. You're like, what? And then you got to look it up. John Dean. All right, I know him, right? But then there'll be somebody else, and you're like, oh, I know that name. You look it up, you're like, oh, wait, that's Deep Throat. The guy in the room is the guy that I know gives all the information to Woodward and Bernstein, right? Like, now I know. And it's cool when you're watching it because you're like, oh, I know what this guy's going to do. That's crazy. How does he get there to do it? G. Gordon Liddy is just an insane human being, like you thought. It's really good.
Well, you had me sold it. Sean Penn. I was going to say, when you and my brothers...
Sean Penn and Julia Roberts, the acting's good.
Yeah, so that sounds good. Have you watched this, The Deep End? Have you heard of this?
No.
So it's on, Freeform, but it's on Hulu. It's about this... it's also kind of based on a podcast, I think, but it's about this spiritual guru. Have you seen it, Snow Cone? Didn't we talk about this?
I started, the... first episode, but I didn't finish it. But my girlfriend said it's really good.
So there was a podcast about this woman here. This is what she looks like, Laszlo. Mm-hmm. She started doing like YouTube, you know, videos on the internet, okay. And started getting more and more popular. Now she does these conferences. You remember the NXIVM thing?
Yeah.
So far, this is very reminiscent of the whole NXIVM thing, and I'm always fascinated
with a good somebody who can cult start thing. A cult. Yeah.
Yeah, like how you get followers, how the followers fall in love with you, you know, and because you're always thinking, could this happen to me?
Sure.
Right. Now, the new Stranger Things is out, but you don't right. love Stranger
Things. I
don't
watch Stranger Things. You watch Stranger Things, Julia?
No.
I love it, and we're going
to
binge
I have tried to start that first episode, I promise you, four times.
I love it.
And I just can't get through it.
And
people are like, you're going to love it, all these 80s references. I'm
yeah,
like,
that's
I
how
don't.
I feel. Josh is really into it. I just I don't know.
Yeah, I'm like, all right.
And I saw they said, well, this season will make up for season three. I love season three. I love Stranger Things, so I'm very excited about season four. And they said that season four was like somehow broke a record for the number of hours that everyone was streaming at the same time. Did you see that? Mm. Something like 170 million hours. Did you watch Candy?
I did.
I thought that's worth watching.
Yeah, it wasn't bad.
That's on what, Hulu?
Hulu.
And then you also love the basketball thing.
If you haven't seen Winning Time, I mean, I don't know what you're doing. Like that, I mean, why? What else? Sit down and watch Winning Time. It's unbelievable.
Is it done?
The first season is over.
It's over. Okay. So there you go. So that's what we're watching. Let's see. Next question. Oh, if you could have one piece of memorabilia, everybody, just one, you just get it. What would it be? I know I just talked about Stifler's backpack the other day, right. But I think I could do better than that.
Oh,
if someone's
going
to give it to me. Well, and how big could it be? Because what if you're like, well, I want the airplane that was used in Top Gun. You know what
right.
I mean? That's memorabilia. Right. I'm guessing there's a limit. Otherwise, I would take something like that. But if you got to limit it to something reasonable, I assume Laszlo's would be something sports related.
Right, I was trying to
the
think.
The bat that
oh,
Cal Ripken used.
The spirit
used
stick from Bring It On.
There you go. The spirit stick from Bring It On.
That is pretty
I mean,
cool.
Imagine having it on the shelf and then yeah. people come over and they're like, hey. What is that? And I'm like, let me tell you.
Right. You don't have to sell me on it. I still
and
think...
I'm like, but don't drop it on the ground.
Right. I mean, that's an amazing, that is going to be a conversation starter for the rest of your life. Anyone who's close to your age. You know what? I'm still just going to take Stifler's backpack. That's the thing. And it'll be hanging in a wall. Maybe I get it framed in glass and people say, why do you have a backpack? It's right. They're like, let me turn on American Pie for you and show you the backpack of the Stifler's frame. What do you think, Laszlo?
I don't know. I was trying to think. Like, I mean, sports memorabilia, you know, the Barry Bonds home run ball worth millions and millions of dollars.
Yeah. I thought you'd take Cal Ripken's bat or something like that.
Right. You know, I mean, the Barry Bonds ball, but I don't know. I'm trying to think of movie stuff, too, like what I would want. You know, what could I get from A Bronx Tale?
Right.
That
just
would
you have to imagine you know that it mean? Still exists. Get Chaz's right. suit or something like right. that. I don't know. But yeah. Just something like that. We're not being crazy. Now, okay, real quick here. I do like this question. What do you guys want to do when you retire? And when I read that, I thought, I never imagined retiring. Do you?
Yeah, I don't.
It seems impossible. Doesn't it?
I just feel like the thing you do is golf, and I can't golf, and nor do I enjoy it.
I feel like you go broke.
What are the other options?
Well, people used to, like, move to Florida and retire, and they had their savings and their 401ks and stuff.
Yeah, I know the Florida move is a big thing.
Oh, I would love to do it. I just...
You know, I enjoy the retirees who have, like, a drinking schedule. Who, like, wake up.
Yes.
They make their one drink. Then right. 3 o'clock, they make another.
Very European.
And then they sit outside by a pool. That sounds nice, but I also can see myself getting bored and antsy.
Oh, no, no. So my dream would be to live in Laszlo's documentary place in Florida, right. where all the old people live. It's
yes.
like a summer camp
it's
with
so
houses.
Good.
But I'll never be able to afford to live there.
You never know.
You never know.
Imagine you do. Imagine yeah. you have a lot of retirement money.
Yeah. Well, then that's where I go.
Yeah, me too. I go to that Disneyland place
yeah,
with all the other old people with Margarita Man.
Yeah,
and, yeah,
Margarita Man, golf
they
carts.
Have, like, golf carts, and golf courses, and acting yeah. lessons. And like, yeah, I just start doing weird stuff.
Yeah, it's like
Tai Chi in my backyard and smoke dope. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, what like form of fitness would you guys take up? So yours would be Tai Chi.
Yeah, I would certainly do that.
I'd try not to take the golf cart everywhere, I guess. I'd walk a little bit.
That's all
I'm going to do.
I would take back up tap dancing. I'd be the oldest.
Right.
I can see that in the documentary. I can see Julia with blue hair tap
right.
dancing mm-hmm. in that resort. So that mm-hmm. Wait a second. We all have the dream of living in that Florida place.
Yeah, together.
Retire.
Yeah.
All right. I like that. That's
how
amazing.
Good would that be?
It would be amazing.
There's just pools everywhere and
yeah. and drinks.
Single old women.
Yes.
Like I mean, I'm old. Look, I'm old too. So I mean, it's perfect. There's yeah. just single women. I'm old. They're old. You know, it all looks good. You know, watching that documentary, though.
What?
I know you felt bad, too. Everybody who watched it felt bad. Anybody who's watched it just texted me and been like, it's okay, man. Yeah. Because I'm that guy.
Yeah, you are.
I am that guy. Everybody's like, you're that guy, man.
Yeah.
Sorry, buddy. And I'm like,
ugh. Yeah.
Because when you watch it, I'm like, I am that guy.
I don't remember. What's the name of that documentary if people want to watch it? We never remember the name of it.
Man.
It was on Amazon Prime, right? Yeah. I think when we watched it, but if you
some keyword Googling and figure it out.
When he is sitting at the table, he moves in with that lady and, you know, she's in love with him and, you know, he seems to be doing well. And then she's like, they sit down to have lunch and she's like, let's put together a grocery list. I know we need peanut butter. And then they go to the voiceover of him and he's like, I knew then I got to get out of this relationship. I hate this. Right. I don't want to go get peanut butter with you. I don't want
to.
And he just leaves.
He
and
could not commit
just
to anything.
Couldn't commit. Just was like, it's just. And to me, that's how I feel. I know. And that's why everybody laughs at me. But that would be something that I would do. Like, I don't want to buy peanut butter with you. I don't. Right. I don't want to do that. Like, such a major commitment. And everybody laughed about it except for me. Like, I got that guy. Like, I get it. I'm like, I hear you. Right. I see you. Your intimacy issues and your inability to, commit, whatever it was the trigger, was that we need to split a jar of peanut butter. And he was just like, I can't do it. Yep. I can't do it. That's all right. I'm like, I can't.
Yep.
Like, it gets that way. Like, you know, we should, you know.
And he was like 95
get macaroni and cheese. I'm like, should get your own. I can't live here anymore. And I don't know why it comes out, but it does. For him, it was peanut butter, and I absolutely understood.
And as we were watching it, like, you know, Brooke and I were watching it, and we go, that's Laszlo. And everyone who knew you that was watching was like, they texted you.
Texted
like,
me like, oh, man, you're like that guy who has the bus who doesn't really live there but hangs out at the pool all day until he gets some girl to, oh, man. I'm like, oh, I get it. Hard to watch.
Was it Some Kind of Heaven? Is that the name?
Yes, Some Kind
of Heaven. There you go. Oh, there's the guy. This is Laszlo. Okay. So yeah, if you want to watch it. Although we did get a text from someone who said, I almost got a divorce because you recommended this documentary.
Right.
And my wife hated it so much she wanted to leave.
Yes.
Because I think he paid to rent it or something.
It was good.
Man,
almost as good as the Jasper Mall.
Oh, yes. Watch that too. Jasper, the first time we recommended two things from Amazon. That Jasper Mall documentary is amazing.
Oh, it's so good.
Just 2 hours of a security guard. He's like a Lion King, Tiger King. But he was the mall king.
Yeah, right, yeah.
You know what I mean? It was the same kind of thing. I liked that guy. Well, we ran out of time because the last question was, they wanted the story from each of us about one time when we pooped our pants as an adult, but I just don't think we have time to get to that. So maybe next week.
Well, yours was recent.
Well, I just have to tell the story of one. That's all.
Yeah, but one of them was recent.
Yeah, but I just figured I'd go with the first time I did it as an adult. And
yeah, but one of them was like within the last month.
Yes,
right?
we talked about it ad nauseum. Yeah. It was. Yeah.
Talked about it in Lifetime.
Because I'm a very open individual. I don't know when Julia did it last. I don't know when Laszlo did it last. I don't know when Snowcone did it last. You guys hide it.
I told you when I did it last. I did it when I was a teacher at Specs Howard.
That was the last time.
That was the last time, yeah.
Good for you.
Wow, look at you, man.
Yeah, that was the last time.
That's amazing. That's like those people who don't puke for 15 years
All right,
or something.
What's going on? Yeah.
You haven't pooped your pants for yesterday.
That long?
Yeah, 15 years.
Longer than that. Need to hear? So someone sent me, someone emailed me this thing today. It's things that guys hate to hear. It's the exact opposite of yesterday.
Did whoever sent it write it?
No. It's from a forum. They asked guys, what do you hate to hear? What's the worst thing that you can hear? And so then they ranked it all. But real quick, before we do that, Laszlo, I wanted to ask you, everyone talking about
even more quick, we're on a subway in Berkeley.
Yes, so that's the big
story. Woodward.
Right. Yeah. What's up, sandwich artist? Love you, man.
So we've been off the air, Julie.
Sweet onion dressing. So good.
We've been doing a little subway research because we heard that we were on there. So off the air, we learned some stuff. According to the internet, Laszlo, did you know when you go into a subway, they're supposed to greet you with welcome to Subway? They have to say that.
They always do.
And I thought they always do.
I just don't think about that.
I don't either, but they do say welcome Subway. And it also says that they'll give you as many veggies as you want, which I also thought, yeah, you know, they've never told me like, sorry, that's going to cost extra. But
I've never asked for extra either.
What would be the one veggie you extra?
Well, for me, unfortunately, it's black olives, which on this list, they say that's one of the things. Tomatoes and black olives. Now, I don't know if this is true. This is from Eat This, Not That. It could be old. But they say there's a limit on black olives and tomatoes. Mm. They say it's not always followed, but Subway has rules for the number of black olives and tomatoes workers are supposed to put on the sandwiches. And I thought of you and Olive Garden.
Yes.
Where America eats dinner. Mm-hmm. And you said they count the olives.
Do they really?
Yeah, the olives and the peppercini. So, like,
well, the peppercinis are big. I can see them counting.
And you're
those.
Supposed to put, like, if you have, so say there's two people at the table in the salad, at least when I worked there. So there's two people at the table, you bring the salad, you give them three.
Three big olives?
When they come, no, or the peppercini. When you're done, when they're done and you pour the salad out, right, you're supposed to look at it. If they didn't eat any of them, then you don't put any back. So, whatever they didn't eat, if they left the black olives at the bottom, don't put any in the thing back. And they had to, you had to dump your salad in a different waste bin.
Yeah.
And it had a line on it. And you didn't want to pass that line of wasted salad.
Makes sense. Mm-hmm. Very efficient. That's how it became America's restaurant.
Right.
Well, hey, Subway.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Now I'm hungry.
Berkeley, what's up?
The Church of Laszlo.
Yo.
Yeah, what?
I was going to say nutty.
We're still talking about black olives, Jim?
Yeah, I didn't.
Slim loves black olives, man.
Since I was a kid, I thought everyone loved black olives. And then I start talking to people like, no, I like the green ones.
Disgusting.
Yeah, me and Snowcone, we don't like olives.
I like green olives, but I don't like black olives.
But you were saying that they taste nutty.
I like all of the olives. I've never met an olive I don't like.
Calamata.
Love it. Love it. Yeah. Love it. I love olives, but black olives are my favorite, possibly my favorite food. But Julia said off the air, we were discussing, she goes, they have a weird flavor. And I said, well, people describe them as nutty. Sometimes.
That's not it.
Yeah, I've heard people say that. Sense. I don't like that necessarily, but they say it's nutty or meaty. And that doesn't make sense to me either, but I just think it tastes like a black olive. Yeah. Hmm.
Who's describing this?
Yeah. You know, people on the radio when they talk about black olives.
I don't think everybody's...
Mm-hmm. Oh, I've heard lots of discussions. Some people have olive trees, you know, depending on where you live. I've heard stories about kids grabbing olives off the olive tree and throwing it at people. I don't know where the olives come from. Maybe that's not true. Maybe
that's
the trees
fine.
Are
I'm just
Alice
asking
Wonderland.
Who describes it as nutty or meaty.
They
Both
say
are two
nutty
different
flavor.
Tastes, by the way.
They say nutty flavor. I have heard it described as that. Hold
no,
on.
No, you haven't.
What are you looking up, Laszlo?
Liar.
Hold on. What are you looking up?
What do black olives taste like?
Look, Julie doesn't
disgusting.
Believe me.
Like.
Julia does not believe me.
They're just salty.
That's what it says.
Well,
which,
like
that's
salt.
Not, that's a flavor added to a nut. That's not the nut's flavor. Sounds so gross. Shut up.
Okay, you know what? I don't know what a, since we're just talking about random food, I don't know really what an actual fig looks like. I've had fig Newtons.
Why are we on figs now?
Well, because you're talking about olives being weird. I think figs are weird, and I've never seen one. I don't know where it comes from, and I know, aren't they kind of a delicacy? Because I've heard those described as meaty, for sure. I've heard it.
No, you
haven't. Yes, they call it fig meat. I've heard it. I'm like, no way.
You're making stuff up.
Fig meat?
I'm not making it up.
I've never heard that.
Grow
I'm telling
up.
You.
You're just trying to be shocking.
No one's ever said fig
on
meat.
On the radio when they talk about figs.
You.
What radio? This?
I heard a guy say, oh, you know, that's a good big one. It's got a lot of meat. And I was like, meat?
No
fig?
One had, no, you're making this
I'm
up.
I'm telling you. I
don't think so.
I've never had one. I don't even know what it looks like. I've had Fig Newtons, but some of the Fig Newton boxes say, like, this does not contain any actual figs. I'm serious. Maybe they were off-brand. I'm not sure, but true story. Broke my headphones. I can't believe you guys don't like black olives.
Disgusting.
Would well, that's fine. I know it's not. I know people really like them. I just don't. Whatever. I love pickles. Not everybody likes pickles.
There you go.
All right. Do you want to hear some things that guys hate to hear before we go?
I guess.
Sure.
Other than black olives are gross. So here's some of the things that guys said that they hate hearing the most. And I want to see if any of these get Laszlo worked up. Stop hiding your emotions. I know you're being emotional.
Yeah, okay. I can't imagine that. That just goes well every time.
Well, here's an emotion for you. It's called anger. I hope it's the one you were looking for.
Oh, boy.
There's
because
the...
I have two. Horribly sad and horribly angry. Those are the two emotions I have.
Why don't you just be a man and blank? You know, whatever the situation is, why don't you just be a man? Who are the people that most likely say that to you?
Your father.
Oh, my dad. Yeah. We didn't talk much.
Well, that sounds like something a father would say.
You couldn't hear like a significant other saying, be a man and get out there.
Get a job. I could hear that. Like, be a man, get out there and get a job. Take care. I could hear that from both a spouse or your father.
Well, when I was a kid, my dad had certain jobs. Like, if the dog pooped on the rug, he had to clean it up. And one time as a kid, I said, why does dad always clean up the poop? My mom said, because that's a man's job. You know, and as I got older, I'm like, why is that the man's job?
That seems like a guy's
it is.
Job.
I do it now, by the way. If
I'm
an animal poops, I clean up. Is it just because we're less likely to throw
love
up
feminism, but that can be a man's job.
I'm
okay with some of those old stereotypes, though. I think you are too, Leslie. You said something yesterday about paying the tab. Like, you appreciate the offer, but you don't want someone else to pay for it. So you can be a little old fashioned. And I'll be honest, if the dog poops, I'll clean it up. That's fine. Here's another thing that guys hate to hear. So this would be your significant other is talking to a friend or something, and the friend says, oh, you've got him well trained. Or she could say to you, I've got him well
trained. That's not that. No, neither people like hearing that.
Right, I've heard that one. That's way more likely for a woman to say to a man.
Terrible on either end of a relationship.
Yes, I agree.
I agree, but isn't that way more likely for a woman to say to a man?
I think it's more likely for like a woman to say to another woman about a man.
Yes.
Yes.
Right? So they're not saying it to you. It's like you're at dinner or something and your boyfriend, you know, you drop a fork and he picks it up and gets you another one, right? And then the lady says the other way, boy, you've got him well trained. That, I think, you hear, right? That, to me, makes sense.
Yes. That's what I envision when I see that. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got him well trained. Someone put on this list, I don't know, as a thing that men hate to hear. And people were discussing it, and I thought about all the time my parents fought. Like getting in the car, and my mom saying, where do you want to eat? Mm-hmm. And my dad says, I don't know, or I don't care. Or she says, I don't know, or I don't care. That almost always led to the brink of divorce. I mean, seriously, my parents would fight, and then we'd have to drive back home. She'd say, just go home, we're not doing this. And it was because someone said, I don't know, or I don't care. And that's what they kept saying. Right. I think both sides hate hearing that, right?
Yeah. Yes.
I don't think that's...
But you guys do it? You're in a relationship, Julia. When you get in the car, do you argue about where you're going to go eat? Because nobody knows where to go eat?
We'll be undecided on where to eat, but I think it'll happen at home before we go. But yeah, I do that.
And do you guys argue about it? Like, does it get a little heated?
It doesn't get heated. We eat really differently. Like, I try to eat as healthy as possible, and he doesn't really. So sometimes we'll just do different places.
Oh, God. Well,
if we're going to dinner somewhere nice, like, then yes, we'll decide. But now we have a few key places that we know we both like and are fine with.
Right. I think that's key.
Yeah. We have 3 to 4 go-tos.
Right. And then before you get to the argument... So I just have those same things with my boys. Because whenever there's more people involved, they always say, like, I don't know. And then you say something like, yeah, not that. So you just have to have, like, 4 places where, like, you know what?
Yeah.
We're just going here.
Yeah. And, like, we have them at different price ranges, too. Like, so if we're trying to have, like, a date night, like, one of those 4 places, or if we're just trying to do something cheap, Qdoba is always, like, a fine line or something like that.
The Subway at Berkeley.
Yeah.
Subway in Berkeley.
We never argue about that. I got my girl well trained. She goes where I want to go.
The Church of Laszlo.
Yo. We're done.
All done.
Good job.
You guys got big plans tonight? You got sports with the boys or anything?
Practice.
You go to practice?
Stuff will be rained out.
You go to practice every time?
I walk around while they practice. You know, I got to be around there. I got to drive them.
Dedicated. Julia, did you guys figure out what you're eating tonight?
No, I'm not that hungry. I got to clean out our guest room. I have someone staying on Friday.
Ooh. I love it when a guest comes to stay.
It's fun. Gives me a reason to clean.
Yeah, and to get up earlier because you feel like, you know, you should eat breakfast with them and chat with them, make sure they know how to use the coffee maker, right? No? Not part of your routine? Okay, well, that's part of mine. I kind of like it. Makes me feel
I see
like
what you're saying, right?
You sound like a good B&B host.
Yeah, like I like it for a couple of days. If someone comes over, I feel like, oh, good. I'll get up early, make sure that they're taken care of or whatever. And then
when I spend the night at your house and you get up, you know, early and make people leave.
Yeah. That magic shower is dysfunctional at my place.
It doesn't work. You have to ask them out.
I know. It's weird. I got to call the guy to put that in because I think I need a refund. But anyway, yeah, you know, it's a weeknight, so no big plans tonight, right?
Yeah, not for me. Nope.
You guys made me hungry. I might go get some Subway.
Mm-hmm. The Subway did sound good after we talked about it so much.
Mm-hmm.
Tuna.
That's the problem.
Tuna's really good.
Yeah.
Have you ever gone in by yourself and gotten two or three sandwiches at once and then just left and ate them all?
All the time.
Oh, okay, good. Because sometimes I'm like, I really want tuna, and then I'm like, but I also really want
pizza. So I might like get a 6-inch tuna and like a 6-inch turkey.
Oh, I see.
Yeah,
that's fun.
Oh, I get the whole thing.
Look at you mix and match.
Yeah, because if you know, they won't give you a, you can't do the 12-inch and I just want half this and half that. So you get two different sandwiches. And I know, okay, well, like if it's dinner time, like I'm alone, right? My kids are at my ex's. I'm like, all right, well, you know, I'll watch TV and have the tuna, and then I know a couple hours later, I'll have the other half, right? Well, you know, knee deep into a musical or something.
Oh, wow. So it can take you that long?
Yeah, I'll eat them separately, you know, at a different time because they're different sandwiches.
Right.
Well, I won't eat them at the same time. Watch? That would be weird.
What musical are you going to watch tonight?
Well, I haven't found one yet. I mean, I did the Bruce Springsteen thing. And
Give them a classical musical, Julia. Something great. Something
Sound
good.
Of Music.
Well, no, I like modern. It's
there's a new
modern.
West Side Story, dude.
Oh.
The Jets. Honestly, West Side Story slaps.
Yeah.
It slaps, Laszlo.
Slaps.
Slaps, man. You got to watch it.
Yeah, that's good.
Is someone in it that I know?
Isn't
there some famous people in it? Oh, you could watch La La Land, dude.
Well, I heard it's good. No cap. Dead ass, man.
Hey, you know I love,
shut
I love
up.
Ryan. Tell me how La La Land is.
Come on, man. I did that good.
That's
I?
Really good. Mm-hmm. Really good.
It's cap.
Benefit.
Anyway, are we done?
We're done.
All right. Good show, Mikey. Stay positive, kids.
The Church of Laszlo.